What I'd like to talk with you about today is the fact that what passes for economic policy and economic analysis is very often, in part or altogether, really about class war.
Hey, is Wolff finally turning over a new leaf? Is he finally going to admit the division between the political class, his class, and the common people?
In which the employer class is taking care of business in the way it wants, even though it's at the expense of the employee class.
Eh, I should have known.
The class that runs the system also makes the key decisions about what policies to use for what problems to solve, and in the process, keep themselves on top and the rest of us looking up at them.
Yeah, we know you do, Wolff.
I'm going to begin with inflation. And here the important thing is to understand the class nature of inflation.
I've covered the real class nature of inflation. Government inflates the money supply. That lets Congress run massive deficit spending while the banks and their cronies get to use the new money first, before any inflationary effects can take place. As it moves through the system, the new money has an upward effect on prices, generally going through the largest corporations next. By the time it gets to the small businesses, the effects are significant. Workers are last in the chain. Since wages are stickier than prices, they're less prone to change, so workers are still getting paid at their old level even as prices have risen. It'll take a while for it to catch up. That's why economists refer to it as the inflation tax. It's a regressive tax on the working class and small businesses to benefit government, banks, and their cronies. But, of course, the last thing Wolff is going to do is admit that he's in the class that benefits from inflation.
I want you to understand the class nature of inflation. To do that, we ask very simple questions, but we give honest answers. First question. If inflation is when prices go up, who exactly sets prices? In other words, who are the people deciding that the price of this hamburger will now be $6 rather than $5, or that the price of this software program will be $200 rather than $100, or whatever else it is?
And the answer? No one. It's set by the price mechanism of the market, and there's a lot of reading you can do on how this works, but it's basically supply and demand. Wolff is going to try to lie to you and tell you that businesses just set the price and you just have to deal with it because you're a poor, stupid schmo who can't make your own decisions.
And the answer to that is a tiny minority of the people in a capitalist economic system make that decision. And those people are called employers.
See? But let's do a thought experiment. Let's say McDonald's gets greedy and sets the price of a Big Mac at $12 million. Why don't they do that? If they're greedy, like Wolff says, why not grab the dough? Because, of course, no one will buy a Big Mac for $12 million. And if they set all their prices that way, they'd go out of business. As anyone who's studied basic economics knows, the reason why they'd increase the price of a burger from $5 to $6 is because they can produce more at that price, selling more units at a higher price and making more money. But of course, that's not gonna work if people won't buy. So fewer people buying the hamburger means they're spending money producing all these hamburgers that aren't gonna be sold, which is a waste of money. Their only choice there is to bring the price back down, to the point where you have more or less an equilibrium between the amount they're willing to produce at that price and the number of burgers people are willing to buy at that price. And if you think about it, this is perfectly logical, and there's really no way it could be any other way. And now you know why socialists like Wolf keep trying to convince you of long-debunked labor theory of value. They're trying to deny the very effect I've just illustrated.
It's the class of employers. You all know that because the vast majority of you and me are employees.
Oh, you've never worked a real job in your life and you know it. You went straight from your Ivy League education into government-funded academia. You've been retired since 2008. You never spent one day in your privileged ivory tower life flipping burgers.
That power to set prices is reserved exclusively for the employers at the top.
You've never spent one day running a business either. Every businessman would love for it to work this way, but it just doesn't. Businessmen do not set prices. They discover the best level where prices should be set at the time. Completely different thing.
A tiny minority set the prices that the rest of us, 99% or more, have to pay. So right at the beginning, an inflation screams at us. Class system, inequality. Some people having extraordinary power to do something as powerful as set prices have decided over the last year to raise prices, which is why we have an inflation.
No, we have inflation because your precious government printed a bunch of money. Here, see for yourself. Jerome Powell actually engaged in a bit of quantitative tightening initially. Something that was much needed after three rounds of quantitative easing, but which caused the political class to freak out. You can see the point where he caved and started expanding the balance sheet again in October 2019. But that's not the real problem. Oh, you can see the real problem, can't ya? As COVID spread through the country, the Fed expanded its balance sheet at a rate not seen since the 2008 financial crisis. The political class of both parties cheered him on. And notice that after that, even though there was a small amount of tightening, it went back to being expansionary up until inflation got so bad that not even politicians and the news media could ignore it. After the highest inflation rate in 40 years, basically when Powell was sworn into another term as chair, we've seen a bit of tightening. But that is why inflation is happening. We're paying the price for government spendthriftiness during COVID.
It is a way for the employers to improve their profits. That's why they raise prices.
No, they raise prices because more people are buying at that price level than they can produce, whether it's due to increased demand or to supply shortages caused by COVID policies or whatever, that's what's going on. When it's raised due to inflation, as it is in this case, it's because businesses experience inflation too. They have to buy things, supplies, services, capital goods, and the price of all of those are now going up. So that means that, at any price level, producers aren't able to make as many units as they otherwise would because of the increased costs. In other words, the supply curve shifts to the left. That increases the equilibrium price, but decreases the equilibrium quantity. They're selling each unit at a higher price, but they're selling fewer units. And if you think through that a minute, you'll see that they really aren't making any more money. It's just being absorbed by inflation. Wolf wants to deceive you and just point to the nominal amount they make, which has gone up, but after adjusting for producer inflation, it really hasn't. Not in terms of the purchasing power of what they make.
A tiny minority of people, employers, set prices, cause inflations.
They don't cause inflation, liar! They're victims of inflation just like the rest of us. This is why socialists like Wolf and other political economists want to monkey with the definition of inflation. Inflation means that something is inflating. What's inflating? The money supply. And that causes prices across the board to rise. But they don't want to admit that. Remember that central banks are a socialist policy. They're one of the planks in the Communist Manifesto, after all. In fact, Marx's measure number 5 was, quote, centralization of credit in the hands of the state, by means of a national bank with state capital and an exclusive monopoly. So the last thing a socialist can do is admit to what the real cause is. So that's why he had to define it as rising prices without getting into why the prices are rising to begin with, to shift the blame from his beloved socialist policy to his much-hated entrepreneurs, who are the real source of wealth in the economy.
And we know why they do so, because it's the most profitable strategy available for them to do it.
Well, then why do they ever drop prices? Why did computers get cheaper and cheaper even as they got more and more powerful? And if you look in real terms, in other words, adjust for inflation, the real price of all sorts of goods have fallen over time. In 2021, the price of a dozen eggs was $1.67. In 1980, the inflation-adjusted price was $2.10. A gallon of milk was $3.54 in 2021, compared to $4.23 in 1995, also inflation-adjusted. And in recent months, we've actually seen a bit of regression in these prices as eggs, milk, gasoline, and other goods and services get marked down again. The prices of goods and services go down all the time. And when they don't, it's generally because of inflation, and they've still gone down in real terms. Why would this ever be the case if Wolf were telling you the truth?
And what is the authority in our society that's supposed to deal with inflation? The answer is, it's our central bank, known in this country as the Federal Reserve.
Well, it's just too bad they're the cause of it. And actually, there was no inflation to speak of before the Fed was created by Congress in 1913. In fact, the history of our country up to that point was actually one of slight deflation.
Clearly, if we have an inflation, the Federal Reserve failed to achieve its first objective.
They didn't fail to achieve it, Wolf. They caused it!
What is the Federal Reserve proposing to do? Answer, raise interest rates. They've been doing it for the last half year in big jumps, as many of you know. This is supposed to be a solution for inflation. Does it punish capitalists and employers for raising prices? No. Does it penalize employers for raising prices? No.
The way the Fed raises interest rates is by decreasing the supply of loanable funds. After their assets mature, they don't roll them over, or at least don't roll over as many of them, so they're just not creating new debt as cheap credit to the banks. That, as you saw on the graph, shrinks their balance sheet through attrition. Why does that raise interest rates? Because Congress is still engaging in deficit spending! If the deficit contracted together with the Fed's balance sheet, interest rates would stay where they are. Something else Wolf doesn't tell you.
The first thing an interest rate hike does is make life more difficult for the poorest people amongst us and for the middle class. Why? Because our credit card bills at the end of the month are going to be higher because the interest rate that's part of that has been raised up. It's going to make life harder for anyone who wants to buy a new or used car because the payments that you'll have to make per month are going to be higher if interest rates are higher.
In other words, debt will be more expensive. But why is more debt necessarily a good thing for people? He's only giving you one part of the equation. While it's bad for debt, it's actually good for savings. And if you're poor, saving is difficult, but no less important. With banks offering higher interest rates for savings, more poor and working class people can get a greater benefit out of their comparatively little savings. But Wolf doesn't want workers saving, because he doesn't actually care about workers. He wants to saddle the working class with more and more debt because it benefits him and his cronies. They are the ones that profit from it.
It is blatantly unjust. And in case anyone thinks that that's the way we have to go, that is simply not true. Back in 1971, then conservative President Richard Nixon declared a wage price freeze.
Oh yeah, because that just worked like gangbusters, didn't it?
The government said, as of tomorrow morning, nobody can raise the price anymore. Whoa, it stopped the inflation on a dime, and it didn't make the mass of middle and low income people pay for it. It went right to where the inflation started, the class of people at the top.
In what way did it stop inflation on a dime? We had almost a decade of high inflation going into double digits. It made a horrible economy where poor people and workers suffered. And the economy didn't improve until Reagan got rid of the wage and price controls, and Fed Chairman Paul Volcker allowed interest rates to rise. They got really bad, in fact, up over 20%. But that's because the inflation rate was 15%. You see, when interest rates are below inflation as they are now, which economists call negative real interest rates, you absolutely have problems with saving, investing, and growing the economy. So under Volcker, interest rates went up, but they didn't stay there. There was a recession, but that's what you need to get everything back into balance after government screws it all up. It only lasted a year, and after that, both inflation and interest rates had dropped dramatically. Everyone was better off. I have no idea who Wolff thinks he's fooling with this outright lie. Certainly no one who lived in the 70s. Once again, we see that Wolff is just smug, elitist swine, brazenly lying to you, convincing you to accept policies that will absolutely make you worse off so that the elites like him can benefit. He does not care about you! So thanks for watching. Please hit like and subscribe, leave a comment, and go to donate.bogosity.tv to keep me doing what I do. And check out all the great content here, like this video selected just for you.